Okay, so good evening, everyone. I want to say thank you to Punina and Wilmer Mukot for reaching out to me and giving me the opportunity to speak to all of you tonight. And so from what I understand, and Shermin asked earlier but I didn't see, like the audience is a mix, right? Some of you are already programmers, some of you are just starting out, and some of you are just curious to what all this is about, right? So to be honest, 20 minutes is not enough time for me to tell you how to do web development. Right, so it's just not lah. So I'm going to talk to you about the why, at least for me, right? So before we get into all that, I should probably introduce myself. My name is Hui Jing. I'm also a front-end engineer like Shermin, and I run Talk.CSS with my friend Chris Lina. This is a shameless plug, FYI. It is the only CSS-centric meetup in Singapore at the moment, and it occurs once every month. In fact, the next one is happening tomorrow, if anybody is interested, at Hackerspace. Okay. So moving on, shameless plug over. So can anybody volunteer and answer to the question, what is the internet? I know she explained just now. Not paying attention, zai zai one, you're all, yeah. Okay, and there's a distinction between the internet and the World Wide Web, okay? I will explain a bit later. So for me, right, I started going online when I was 11, and this was my World Wide Web, okay? This one, my favorite. Does this sound familiar to anybody at all?
Yeah, yeah.
If it doesn't sound familiar to you, you can probably guess how old I am already, lah. Okay. But whatever I'm doing right now has absolutely nothing to do with what I learned in school. Okay? The fact that I'm working on the web and getting paid for me is still very amazing. And like, my degree is probably hanging on my dad's wall somewhere. I mean, because he like kind of paid for half of it, right? They should have it. So, okay. I hope everybody knows what this is. In case you didn't know, it is a basketball. And it was and still is one of the most important things in my life. It's safe to say I wouldn't be sitting right here in front of all of you without it. You stay with me. Got point one, serious. Got point one, got point one. So I have a typical Asian family, right? You know, study hard, do well in school, don't get in trouble, very standard stuff. And both my mom and dad were educators. And I have two older siblings. I might have been an accident. But I was the only one who got herself involved in some athletic endeavor, right? So at the time, I felt the elder generation didn't approve of this whole basketball playing thing. The siblings were great. Siblings very supportive. But at the time, I felt that the elder generation didn't approve of this whole basketball playing thing. So at least I perceived it as such, lah. You know, like teenagers. So at the time, teenage me decided that the only way I could get their approval was to be so good that they had to be proud of me. But long story short, I managed to play for the Malaysian women's national team for about 6 years. So the thing is, when you're on the national team, it's a full-time thing. Basically, your life is like this. You wake up, you train, then you eat. You take a nap. Then you wake up, then you train, and then you eat. Then you go to sleep. And then you do it again the next day. Okay, if you need to go to school, you do that. But most of us are free to do whatever during the in-between downtime. So for me, I became the IT person. So there was a lot of, in the 6 years, Hui Jing, my computer cannot boot. Hui Jing, my document cannot print. Hui Jing, internet cannot connect. Which is, okay, fine. Then one fine day, my coach was like, Hui Jing, you're reasonably good with computers, right? That means you can also build websites. And I was like, But because I had so much time on my hands, I'm like, okay, I will figure it out. No problem. So there was a lot of copying other sites' code. There was a lot of Googling. But I actually managed to slap together something that worked. Granted, it was a steal of like handwritten code, then plus code stolen from other people's website, plus I don't know what else. And then my coach said, oh, very good. I want to add more content. I was like, wow, siao liao. And I'm like, okay, version 2. Version 2 it is. So that's how I started, right? But really, I learned most of what I know now a bit later when I sort of amazingly managed to get myself employed as a web developer. And I did. There was a lot of learning on the job. And here is why I find the internet and the web so amazing. So like the question I asked just now, the answer actually, the internet is a network of networks that connect all the world's devices to each other. And the internet was conceived by a group of smart, talented individuals working out of the Advanced Research Projects Agency called ARPA back in 1958. Okay, this is the let me tell you a story portion of the talk, okay? So here are the four original computers. They were connected to the first network ever built. So as you can see, the computers, they were monolithic machines, they're very big. And these computers, they were mostly found in universities. Like, they took up like rooms, right? And they were very expensive to build. And most importantly, they couldn't talk to each other. So like, you couldn't copy a program from one machine to another. You had to rewrite it for your own program. It's like, ooh. And another thing is, given how expensive computers were at the time, it also wasn't efficient to let just one user use one machine at one time. So there's this thing called time sharing. And it's allowed large groups of users to access and run programs on the mainframe at the same time. So data was actually transferred over telephone lines. But using telephone lines for this is unreliable, it's costly, it's inefficient, because data communications is a bit different from making a phone call. Like, if you're making a phone call, you need a constant open line of communication so your conversation can take place, you can hear the replies and everything. But data is bursty. So what happens is that it will torrent out in a short burst, and then it's a period of like non-activity. So if you keep the line open, right, most of the time the bandwidth is wasted. So the concept of packet switching could solve this particular problem, and incredibly, it was conceived of independently by three people. So these three guys, they are called Leonard Kleinrock, who was out of MIT, a man called Donald Davis, out of the National Physical Laboratory out of the UK, and Paul Barron, out of Rand Corporation in California. So it's like three separate people, three separate places, but they thought of this same thing concept at around the same time period. So what packet switching does, it will break up the data into discrete packets and send it over the network, and they will be reassembled at its destination. So this concept. So such an implementation would require something known as routers, which were small computers known as Interface Message Processor, which IMPS, which is quite a cute name, lah. So these IMPS had to be, each node had to have an IMP connected to it, so it could handle all the packets that came in. So then, okay, you got concept, then you need somebody to actually build these things, right? So what happened is that ARPA, if you remember, I mentioned earlier, ARPA is the other people who actually researched this whole internet network thing. So in 1968, ARPA issued a request for quotation to build this. It's like request for quotation, RFQ. Like after 50 years, oh, times have not changed. Now governments still do things like that. Okay. So the contract was awarded to a small company known as Bott, Baranek and Newman, so BBN. And they beat out very established players like IBM, Raytheon, those are very, very big companies. These guys, I think they're not very big, like maybe 20 guys. But it was the fact that they actually won this contract. It's very indicative of the anti-bureaucratic nature of how the internet was built. And even though they were very small in size, Robert Kahn, who was one of their researchers, they described themselves, they are the cognac of the research industry. Very distilled. So, and it was clear they knew exactly what they were doing as compared to maybe the bigger boys, right? Because they were the only people, they submitted a 200-page proposal complete with flowcharts, tables, calculations, detailing exactly how the IM would work. So like these guys knew their stuff, and that's how they got the contract. So the original protocol for this whole packet switching thing, it was written to handle communications between hosts on the same network. But after they successfully demonstrated at this international conference, the International Conference on Computer Communications in 1972, the challenge to the team was, how do you expand this protocol to allow different networks that ran on different technologies to communicate with each other? So how to create an internet, right? So what came out of that is something known as TCP/IP. And this may be familiar to some of you because we are still using it today. It's Transmission Control Protocol, Internet Protocol. So this is the foundation on which open architecture networking was built on. This concept, it allows any computer and network to speak freely with one another regardless of the technology or hardware or software they are running. So the internet was built to be open. And this is the internet. So the next thing I want to talk about is the web. So the web is a bit more recent. It was formally invented by Sir Tim Berners-Lee on March 12, 1989 as a means for researchers to share information. And this is what he wrote in an open letter during the web's 28th birthday earlier this month. So he said, "I imagine the web as an open platform that will allow everyone everywhere to share information, access opportunities, and collaborate across geographic and cultural boundaries. An open platform." Think about this. This is not normal, okay? I'm sure most of us have used Microsoft Word, Microsoft Office at some point in our lives, if not every other day, some of you, right? My dad has Office 97 in his computer at home. And if you tried to open a document that you created using the latest version of Office on my dad's computer, you cannot. But that's a pretty common situation when it comes to software. So it's like version compatibility is very normal. You don't even think twice, like, oh, old document can open, no, never mind, no, bopian. But the web is different. In fact, you can actually still access the very first website ever built. I go open for you. So, unsurprisingly, it's called the World Wide Web. this is literally the very first website ever built. And you can still open it, no problem. So, this is actually very amazing. Like, from hardware to software, the whole thing, this whole concept of internet web is built to be open, you know? Like, nobody have to, there's no centralized authority. You don't have to ask for anyone's permission to publish a website. You can just go ahead and do it. And that's just amazing to me. Like, there isn't anything else like this, you know, right? Like, if your friend from Argentina has a website, you can just type in the URL and then go and see it, you know? You don't need passport, don't need visa, there's no national boundaries online, and which is why there have been some concerns raised recently over restrictions on the web, because it goes against the principles on which the web were built. But that being said, the web today is still reasonably open, you know? But some of us might be unintentionally creating barriers to access, you see? Web technologies, as Shermin had mentioned, is advanced really quickly these few years. So what it took to build a website 10 years ago was a lot simpler than what we have today, right? And at the same time, you know, bandwidth has improved, internet speeds have gotten much faster, browsers have gotten much smarter. But the problem is, this progress has been very uneven, you know? Like, in places like Singapore, you know, very fast, very advanced, and then there are places that are not as rich as Singapore that the advancements for them is a lot slower, you know? And the web is an informational medium, and Shermin touched on this earlier also, content is number one. We go online to find out things. So, sure, the information can come in all types of formats nowadays, as opposed to, you know, the first, like, this first website that is just text, right? So, the thing is, okay, go back first. Look at his Sir Tim Berners-Lee handsome face. The priority is still content. So you need to understand that when we go online to access information, this data has to be sent from our devices from somewhere else. So I know Shermin already covered this. I'm going to cover it again because, you know, refresher just happened to overlap. Okay, should have probably discussed this before. But anyway, this is my version of the explanation. So first, a HTTP request is sent from your browser to the server where the website lives. And then the server will get this request, and then it will send a HTTP response back to your browser, which contains a payload of HTML. So this is the key here, right? That's the first thing that your browser gets back. So then your browser will receive this HTML, then it will start to parse it to sort of render the website. So it will read the HTML, and then it will start to build the website, build. So as it goes through the HTML, and then if it encounters a new resource, it will actually have to send another request to the server and say, hey, give me back. So give me back the resource. So it could be, oh, give me back the style sheet, or give me back the JavaScript, or give me back the image. So, but the first thing that your browser gets is the HTML. HTML is like the key. So after that, send again, then it gets a new style sheet. So it has to read the style sheet, then okay, make the website look pretty. You get your scripts, okay, come back, then okay, if you need to interact, you need to shift around, like whatever. So then the scripts also get executed. And then finally, the browser will render the page on the screen, and then you get annoyed that it took too long. Which is, yeah. So that's generally what happens behind the scenes. So I'm going to make the bold assumption that almost everyone here has experienced websites that take forever to load, or sometimes like not at all. Wow. Especially if you're like surfing on your mobile device, right, and then the line not very good. in Singapore, I think it's not that bad because you guys are like the world's second best country for digital connectivity. But like, I mean, Singapore is like the Asian exception, right? It's like your whole country is a city, right? But like Shermin, right? I also Malaysian, yes. And I just got back from Perhentian last week. So now Judy, Malaysia, I must like rep my country. In case you didn't know, Perhentian is up in Terengganu. It's a very beautiful and very chill place. But the key is, there was barely any cell service. Actually, if like in Malaysia, when we are traveling between states on the highway, your cell service is like the connectivity is like sporadic. Like practically there'll be dead spots and cannot connect. It's not just data, no, there's no cell service literally. So most people now they use smartphones to go online, right? That's just the direction we are moving in. Especially in developing countries like India, like Indonesia, Africa. In fact, in China, almost 90% of the internet users go online using a mobile device. The main difference across countries is just the type of mobile device used. In general, the type of content most people are trying to access is pretty much the same. It's like just everybody just wanna go on Facebook, right? So if after tonight you feel inspired and interested to pursue web development further, I would like to bring your attention to a few concepts I hope will form the foundation of your approach to developing for the web. So you may have or you will soon hear this term, progressive enhancement. And this term has been around for more than a decade, and still there are some people who are confused about what it really is. And the definition that I settled on is that the core functionality of a website should be available without CSS or JavaScript. Because progressive enhancement is a development approach, not so much a technology choice. So like it's not supposed to dictate like what you use to write your code. It's an approach. And in fact, to me, if your purpose of your website is to inform and communicate a message, right, then it is mandatory that the content be there. If the content is not accessible, that's considered failure. Okay, and networks can be unreliable. So what we want to do is we want to reduce the incidence of such failures in spite of like bad connections. So assuming you type your URL correctly, your device is kind of connected to something, HTML is the first thing that your browser receives after the initial response was made, and the content must be there. You know? So you remember as I mentioned earlier, right, as the browser passes the HTML, it will send additional requests to the server for like the extra resources. So think of it like you are shooting a basketball. Okay? If you take one shot and you make the one shot, you 100% for the game, okay? Like, sweet. The more shots you take, the odds that you will miss also go up. So it's the same concept. The more requests that you make, the odds that some of them will fail also goes up, right? So if you're relying on CSS or JavaScript to render the content on your site, I'm not saying you can't, you can. I'm just saying that you're increasing the odds that your user might be faced with a blank page. And, okay, this code here, because Shermin covers, so I never cover. Moving on. This code here was pulled from a case study by Airbnb. So Airbnb, like, doing well, they're a popular site these days. So performance is pretty important to them. So actually, they went through a whole optimization exercise to increase their performance. And they realized that the secret to making their site look super fast is to serve up real HTML instead of waiting for the client to download JavaScript before rendering. Who knew? Wow, mind blown eh. I mean, come on. Okay. Point is, optimization is not optional. So it's common sense. The lighter your site or your app, the faster it loads, the less data it consumes, it's less expensive to visit. And optimization encompasses a lot of things. It's a long checklist. Some of them you can automate or you can take care of it near the end of the development process, like images and fonts, like minification, you can probably do it like just before you deploy, things like that. But being mindful of how you structure and write your code, it has to happen from the start. And that comes with experience. Reading articles and tutorials will help, but you'll learn best from actually writing the code yourself. Eventually, everyone's going to settle into a style of writing that suits you the most, and that's fine. If you work with a team, you will all have to agree to certain standards and practices also. But there are some universal principles that apply regardless of your style. So what I want to say is learn vanilla HTML, CSS, and JavaScript first. I really, really want to stress this point. All the frameworks and libraries can come later. They will always be there waiting for you. But understanding and mastering the basics will put you in control of the framework or library instead of the other way around. HTML and CSS are quite forgiving in that if you write it very rubbishly, right, your website can still probably work, albeit not very well. Okay, I don't know if you've experienced this, but I visited websites, right, that make my CPU go from 46 degrees to 76 degrees, and then my fan like, and I'm like, what is going on? Or sometimes, you know, like you go to sites, right, then they'll load like megabytes of unoptimized images and like 1,001 JavaScript libraries. And half of these libraries probably not even used. It just loads, everything is just very bloated, very slow. And I'm sure we can all do better than that, right? I mean, this is a point. Being a web developer, it doesn't sound like much, right? We're just, you know, you're just building a website or an app. But remember that the web is a gateway to a treasure trove of knowledge and information. And I'm speaking for myself right now. But even though I sometimes rant about, oh, why my job so hard? Oh, why must support so many browsers? Oh, you're kankor lah. But I truly do not think what I do for a living is hard. Okay, to me, hard is being a refugee fleeing from war. Hard is being a migrant worker. You are earning a pittance to support a large family back home you don't even get to see. Okay, hard is like having to make a choice between paying your rent so you won't get kicked out and buying food for your young kids. Now, what we do for a living, that is not hard. But our actions, however small, do make an impact. You know, making knowledge accessible to everyone, regardless of their social status, can make a difference. And even if just one person benefits, that's one more than if we didn't make the effort to do it. So I just want to close off with a quote. Like her, quotes are a thing. I just want to close off with a quote from one of my all-time favorite conference talks. Actually, the link is there. I'm also using the same framework as her, so I will share these links. Clickable, this is a website. The slides is a website. But the quote here is, "The world is generally changed by people who just want to live out their ordinary lives. By people who are just trying to get home. Ordinary people like you and me." Yeah, thank you. Okay, done. Close. Next, moving on.